position?
I left my position as associate director at Trinity Menlo Park, and I decided to walk the Camino de Santiago, a 500-mile pilgrimage across Spain. On my 55th birthday, I went in search of adventure on my own and also discernment about what shape my ministry would take next. Now, millions of pilgrims have walked this ancient route in the Middle Ages, and the end of the pilgrimage, you visit the bones of St. James in the cathedral in Santiago. And it is pretty cool because St. James was one of Jesus' disciples. And when you get there, you see this silver sarcophagus. And there he is. And you also get to hug a giant statue of St. James. And you should ask Jocelyn, because Jocelyn has also done the Camino, and she has also hugged St. James. She has a great picture. So millions of pilgrims walked this route in the Middle Ages. And mysteriously, in the last 25 years, millions of modern pilgrims have revived the Camino. Because of injuries, it took me 3 different trips to make it all the way to Santiago. But that was okay. I learned how to walk at my own pace and to enjoy the journey as it unfolds. And those were pretty profound things to learn. So you wonder, what is a day on the Camino like? Well, every day I woke up in my bunk bed and slathered my feet with Vaseline, which sounds awful, but it prevents blisters, put on my wool socks and boots, shouldered my backpack, and all around me, fellow pilgrims were doing the same thing. And one by one, we were off, stepping onto the path, sometimes before sunrise, walking at our own pace. After hiking for 5, 6, sometimes 7 hours, and stopping for cafe con leche, or a vino tinto along the way, I arrived at my destination for the day, walked into another hostel, claimed another bunk bed, and took off my pack. And I did that routine over and over again. And surprisingly, it was a recipe for joy. Walking the Camino was this glorious mixture of physical exercise, time alone to meditate and pray, and visiting amazing historic sites. Walking the Camino was also very social. Every time you saw a pilgrim, you would say, "Buen Camino, Buen Camino." That was one piece of Spanish everybody knew. And you talked to fellow pilgrims as we walked, and these pilgrims were from all walks of life. Students, young men and women, middle-aged people changing careers or experiencing life transitions, women like me walking alone, retirees, and even people in their 80s and 90s. Most hotels and hostels hosted communal meals for pilgrims, and I often found myself seated around a table with people from France, Spain, Holland, Germany, Italy, and Korea. Occasionally there was another English speaker, but I was often the only American, which was really interesting. Europeans seldom learn Spanish as a second language, so my little bit of California Spanish was very helpful. But always, being the only person at the table who didn't have a fluent language in my back pocket was definitely a lesson in humility, as was learning to appreciate hostel hospitality, mostly sleeping in dorm rooms with other tired and snoring pilgrims. And looking back, this is definitely pre-COVID. So humility, hospitality. Today in our passage from Luke, Jesus teaches the Pharisees about both humility and hospitality. The Pharisees of Jesus' time followed the Greek custom. custom of dining while reclining on couches. And guests jostled for the most desired spot next to the host. Luke tells us that Jesus noticed this jockeying for position and told them to not take the honored seat because you might be demoted by those with more status. Instead, sit at the lowest place, and the host may call you to move closer, and you will be honored. He says, for those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He tells the host also that instead of inviting those of his same social circle who will reciprocate, he should invite those who don't have the resources to entertain, the poor, the lame, the blind, and the crippled. He says, you will be blessed because they cannot repay you. Last Sunday, we saw Jesus expand the boundaries of the Sabbath. And today we see him expand the boundaries of hospitality. He advocates hospitality for hospitality's sake and generosity that expects nothing in return. He shows us a kind of egalitarian banquet where everyone is included. He shows us that love flows when we open the doors of our hearts. Being a pilgrim on the Camino gave me a taste of this way of life. No one talked about who they were back home, what they did for a living, what car they drove, what college they attended, what neighborhood they lived in. We were all pilgrims together. The social hierarchy had somehow been flattened. We were headed the same direction, and we looked out for each other. I sometimes have the feeling that I met Camino angels just when I needed help, when I ran out of water. And I try to live in that practice of mutuality. This practice of mutual love is the bedrock of Christian community. It's what set the early Christians apart from Roman society. And I think it's what made Christianity immediately successful. In a cruel world, the early Christians cared for the stranger and the persecuted. The early Christians took care of the sick, the disabled, and the elderly, rather than discarding them at the side of the road because they had no social value. To the early Christians, everyone had equal value before God. And this was revolutionary in the Roman world that put a price on everything, including human life. The early Christians formed communities of mutual love that flourished. We live in a sophisticated 20th century, 21st century world here in the Bay Area. But there are rips in that social fabric. We scramble for seats at the banquet of society. Our housing market is distorted by wealth, and thousands live in their cars or in squalid homeless encampments on the side of the freeway. The 20th century, the 21st century, has much in common with the first century. That kind of mutual love found in the ancient Christian community still has the power to heal. While I was walking the Camino, I saw similarities between the pilgrim community and my caring church communities at home. At church, we may ask you what you do, where you live, but we are here for a higher purpose, to worship together. We are on a pilgrimage here at church, too, especially, I believe, when we walk up to the altar to receive communion. We are sacramental pilgrims. We are at all ages and stages of faith. It may seem like the most natural thing to walk up and receive communion, and it may seem for some like a huge leap of faith. But we are all members of that ancient and future community of saints who go back to the disciples at the Last Supper, like James, and we continue to clear the path for those who will follow us. Here at St. Paul's, you have created a place of mutual love and care. And we worship here in the footsteps mutual love. Somewhere along the Camino in 2013, I realized that my vocation was now going to be interim ministry. And it has been a wonderful pilgrimage of meeting new people and being a steady presence in the midst of transition at various churches. I love being an interim, but it always means saying goodbye to people I've begun to love and care about, especially here, where I am just getting settled in, it seems like, after 3 months of Sundays. Our reading from Hebrews says, "Let mutual love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing that, some have entertained angels without knowing it." You all have shown me such hospitality and warmth this summer. You have been like Camino angels to me. And I have thoroughly enjoyed being here at St. Paul's. And now it is time for me to walk on and continue my ministry wherever it leads me.